Morning, it's UP journalist and associate professor Yvonne Chua, who is the Philippine partner of the digital news report produced by the Oxford University Reuters Institute for the Study of Journalism. Professor Chua, good morning. Thank you for accepting our invitation.
Hi, Mike. Good morning. And thank you for inviting me.
All right. So, Professor, first off, for the benefit of our viewers, briefly explain to us the extent of your involvement in the Philippine section of the digital news report. Is it accurate to say that you prepared this part of the report?
Well, the report actually is, let me stress, a study of the news consumption habits of people around the world in 46 media markets, including the Philippines, which means it is a perception survey, trying to find out what people think. The Philippines was included in the report for the first time in 2020. By the way, the report has been running for 12 years, 12th edition this year. Since 2020, I've onboarded the project. So I'm part of one of the partners who also give inputs. We have our annual discussion on what else or how else to refine the report. And then I do the country profile for Reuters.
Talk to us about how you conducted this study. How many respondents were there? How did they respond? Is this an online survey?
Yes, precisely. So let me stress again, this is a news consumption habit survey. So it's a perception survey. What the Reuters Institute does annually is it gathers over 90,000 respondents from 46 media markets in six continents. In the case of the Philippines, there were 2,280 plus that participated in the online survey administered by YouGov, which is a survey outfit. In the case of the Philippines, as well as in other markets, the Reuters Institute strives to make the sample as representative as possible of the population, meaning to say the sample is weighted based on age, gender, region, education, and to some degree income and also your political beliefs. So it is, but like any online survey, as we know, there are, because it is an online survey precisely, it could underrepresent certain voices. For example, those who are a bit older who are not online may likely be underrepresented compared to those who are younger.
And those who don't have access.
So it's very, Reuters Institute is very careful that this is a study of an online survey of adult respondents. And one of the things we are also mindful of is because it is precisely an online survey, if there's a difference, say, of 2 percentage points, let's say it's 46% versus 48%, we don't really interpret it as significant or meaningful. It has to be like close to a difference of 3 percentage points.
Right. Now, one of the more controversial aspects of the report, Professor, is that on the trust score of selected news organizations in the Philippines. What exactly did you ask respondents when you assessed the trust score of an organization?
Okay. The survey has a list of 15 leading brands in the country. So there are like 4 from television, 4 from print, 4 from online. And then there's also a number of community organizations as well as leading news magazines. So there are just 15 brands on that list. And Reuters Institute has always stressed that it is not an exhaustive list. Not everybody's there. So the question there is, each of the respondents is asked to assess how trustworthy is the news that they get from a particular brand, and the brand is listed. So they have an option of from 0 to 10. And the way we classify it is if you gave an answer of 6 to 10, then you fall under trusted. So you trust the news from that organization is trusted. From 0 to 4, that is you don't trust it, and then 5 is neither trust nor distrust.
All right. Now, a fundamental question, Professor, that was raised by Mary Aressa yesterday is, how do you define trust? She said on Head Start, how do you decide what trust is when the world can't decide what the facts are? So in that study, is there a definition of trust, or do you rely on the judgment of the respondent how that person interprets what to him or her is trust?
Basically, as you know, since this is an audience research, so it's essentially how the audience perceives or believes in that, in the news content from a particular brand. How much do they trust the brand? So that's how basically it works.
So there's no single criteria for that, except that how they perceive it. Like, there are no barometers or no parameters. How do you define trust, right? So, but Maria was pointing out that this particular, or that in countries like the Philippines, where supposedly there's disinformation waged by the government or social media, what you are actually measuring is impact of disinformation, not the trust in the media. Professor Emily Bell from Columbia University said that the report fails to take into account the impact of disinformation campaign in countries where governments attack the media or the bias in tech platforms who have control over news distribution. How would you respond to these criticisms?
Again, if you have tracked the report over the years, you will find that, and even up to now, the Writers Institute tries to ask or has asked the audience how they perceive disinformation. And it has actually asked them, to what extent have you been exposed to disinformation or misinformation? To what extent you are concerned over disinformation that that you come across in your country? And even identify who they feel, this year they didn't include that, but at least in the last 3 years, who they perceive are, you know, the leading or the main sources of misinformation or false or misleading information, as well as the platforms. And this has been, since I onboarded, I have actually been writing about the results. Like, for example, the Philippines has one of the highest exposure to misinformation. Over the last 3 years, we have seen this coming primarily from politicians. Facebook, in I think 2 years ago when we tracked that, was the leading source of false, or at least perceived to be the leading source of misinformation in the country. And interestingly, this year, what we've also found out is since politicians tend to be like the main source of misinformation, as well as in that case, what we've also asked this year specifically is, how, to what extent media criticism, the bad mouthing of journalists, so that would include disinformation to a great degree, how it has impacted trust levels of brands. And we see that there is a correlation. So writers took time out to explore the data sets and found a correlation between media criticism and the low trust levels in certain countries. And the Philippines emerged as one of those with the most disturbing correlation. And that was pointed out by Reuters.
Is that finding, though, broken down into a particular organization, for example? Because I guess the beef of Mayoresa and Raptor is that they rank lowest in terms of the trust score. And so they're asking, what is the value of that brand trust score if that does not reflect, or if that does not actually take into account attacks by the government or bias of tech platforms? So and you also pointed this out, actually, in that report, that some of independent media outlets who are respected for their reporting are often actively distrusted by the respondents. So what then is the value of having that ranking? This year you didn't rank it, but you still have the scores, which will show who actually got the highest score, who got the lowest brand trust score. So what's the value to that?
Yeah, but let me first stress that even since I started writing, I think the reader should take time out to read the country profiles themselves. And if you really read it from year one, 2020, for the Philippines, I have consistently written about how news organizations like ABS-CBN and Raptor, the ones that have been demonized by government, actually suffer or have low trust levels or higher distrust scores. And this has been a consistent theme throughout the country profile in the country profile, either as part of the context for the charts that you see, as well as in the text itself. In fact, the Philippines is the one that keeps highlighting the fact that the low trust scores could be a result of the attacks on the media, on journalists, on the cases that have been filed against them. And it's no different this year. We stress it again that independent media that are at the receiving end of government attacks are likely to suffer low trust scores. In terms of ranking them, that was a practice in the past. That was a practice in the past. When I joined, that was already the practice. But because of Maria's inputs last year, when Raptor first brought that up, Writers Institute did respond and decided to redesign it so that it's now, as you'll see, alphabetically ordered or arranged instead of by scores. But the scores remain there because that's part of the survey, and we would like to disclose as much information as possible, because some news organizations have given feedback how useful this has. Local ones have useful it has been for them in terms of understanding better their audiences, the way they are perceived by some sectors of society. And the study itself in general, they said, have helped them identify what are news deserts, or what could have been news deserts, where the gaps are in terms of our news coverage and our news reporting.
Are we able to determine, Professor, from the results? Because you mentioned, you noted that the reason why probably some of the news organizations are least trusted is because of the attacks from either the government or the supporters of the government. But are we able to determine from the survey if there's a correlation between the editorial thrust of an organization with the trust score? Meaning, if you are critical of the government, you would likely rank lowest in terms of the trust score, while if you are, say, safe, you would tend to rank higher. Is that something that we can conclude from this brand trust score ranking?
We haven't done the correlational analysis, Mike, but I think we could probably, if you were first to classify which ones are safe, right, or engage in safe reporting, and then the trust scores, we probably would be able to establish a correlation or find out if there is a correlation or not. But at the moment, there is no such finding. However, there is an interesting finding, and that also has to do with trust scores. And that is, Writers Institute has found that in countries where the press freedom index is lower, these are countries where you also tend to find lower trust scores in news and in the media.
Interesting. Right. But I guess the criticism about the bias of tech platforms, that's beyond the scope of your study, because as you mentioned, this is a perception survey.
Yes, precisely. It's an audience research. Yes. So, and as you know, Reuters, this is just one of the products of Reuters Institute. It also does other sorts of journalism research. They've done trust in news projects. So, and that's rather structured differently. So in this case, we've never concealed the fact that this is like a news consumption habit survey. So it's really audience-based.
Should the Reuters Institute for the Study of Journalism, though, take responsibility if the study is being weaponized or abused by some government officials or supporters of the government? Because that's what Raptor is saying. It was weaponized against them. The least trusted moniker was being tagged, citing the survey. And some academics and journalists are saying, in this era of disinformation, journalism research should be advocating for journalism. What do you say to that?
You're a journalist, I'm a journalist, and we have also seen our stories being abused by the audience, by bad actors. It's not just the Reuters Institute survey, but other surveys have also been weaponized, as some would like to put it. Should we hold that survey organization to account because they're, or should I hold you to account if your story gets weaponized? I think what we should do is to really respond to the criticisms, or the way, or expose how people, or how bad actors misuse the information.
And lastly, Professor, there's one aspect that's also interesting in that study. How would you account for the downward trend for TV and print media as sources of news in the Philippines, as opposed to online and social media? And the graph that you show there was, it started in the year 2020. The usage for social media and online would be hover around 70% up, while you have TV at 52% and print even lower. And we know that 2020 is the start of the pandemic. That also was the year when ABS-CBN shut down its broadcast operations. Did it have any effect on news consumption of traditional media, say the shutdown of ABS-CBN?
Yes. The ABS-CBN closure is a very big factor in the drop of consumption or usage of television news. And that was already seen in 2021. When we did the first survey in 2020, this was before the closure of ABS-CBN. Mm-hmm. And you see right away that in 2021, ABS-CBN was still the leading news source among Filipinos. But the year after, in 2021, it slid. And the percentage point was really, really massive. Together with the other, the slowly declining consumption of television news, plus the closure, it really quite explains the rather drastic drop in the Filipinos patronizing television. In fact, it's really a big drop, if I'm not mistaken. It's like from 66%. In 2020 overall for television news to 52. That's a 14 percentage point drop. It's so huge. Whereas the others are just suffering, like even print, 8 percentage point. Well, maybe because they didn't start out with very high numbers. But even for radio news, the drop was like 8 percentage points. Television, this is number one medium, of course, in the Philippines before the pandemic and before the closure of ABS-CBN. The drop was really significant. And although there's no correlation, of course, there's no study, I really think, even from the very start, and I've stated that in my report, that the closure of ABS-CBN had a lot to do with the drop. All of a sudden, we have news deserts around the country, especially in the regions.
Did it lead, though, to the rise of social media and online consumption?
I think that's quite expected. In fact, you will also see that alongside the rise, when we talk of social media and online, the consumption of traditional brands that have gone online and are on social media, that has also gone up.
I see. So they're shifting, but the shift, are there also portions of a population who have really stopped consuming the news because of the shutdown?
This is something that I noticed, because you would expect that once ABS-CBN closed, that the numbers, right, the loss, a percentage point loss, would be distributed across right the networks, and some would benefit. But actually, after the spike the following year, it has pretty much plateaued. So there hasn't really risen. So where did all that audience of ABS-CBN go? Where did majority of them go? Probably online, right? Maybe they're still with you. I'm not sure. Maybe they're still with you, but watching you online.
All right. On that note, unfortunately, we don't have much time, but thank you so much for joining us this morning, Professor Yvonne Chua.
It's a pleasure. Bye-bye.